Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Good to see everyone here tonight. Welcome to our church service on Christmas Eve. And also welcome to those who may be watching over Facebook as we're recording this or streaming it live tonight, as also for other services as well. So we want to welcome everybody being here, and we're glad you're here. And well, you know what? This is kind of the Christmas Eve that I remember, clear and cold. And sometimes a few flakes in the air now and then, but for the most part, clear and cold. I just want to make at least one announcement, and that is in the back of the church, you'll see that there are some rosettes that are in packages of three. You're able, or you can take as many as you want until they're gone. So we want to thank Julie Weaver for providing those, and so we give thanks for that. So there you go. All right, well. We begin our worship this evening in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And now we turn to the real bells.
Thank you.
Please rise as we continue our service with the lighting of the Advent candle. Candles. So we turn to our dialogue as we begin. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light.
The light shines in darkness, and darkness has not overcome it. Those who dwell in the land of deep darkness, on whom the light has shined, we have beheld Christ's glory, glory as the only Son of the Father.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given.
Amen.
This is a season of prophecy and peace. You're on, rise, shine.
Rise to the light of the sun, and glory of the Lord has risen upon you. See darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness over the peoples. The Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn.
This is the season of Bethlehem and peace.
And you, O Bethlehem of Bethlehem, who are one of the little that you, and you shall come forth for me, one who is ruled over Israel, who is Lord and is from old, from ancient days.
This is the season for shepherds and joy.
He comes to walk like a shepherd, he gathers the lambs in his arms, and carries them in his heart, he gently leads the mother sheep.
This is the season of angels and love.
In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to go to the place he married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The Virgin's name was Mary.
And the words are a little bit different. The final candle is lit in John chapter 8, verse 12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Let us join together as we pray together the prayer that is found in your bulletin together. Let us begin. Loving Father, help us remember the birth of Jesus, that we may share the song of the angels, the gladness of the shepherds, and the wisdom of the wise men. Close the door of hate, and open the door of love all over the world. Let kindness come with every gift, and good desires with every greeting. Deliver us from evil, by the blessing which Christ brings, and teach us to be merry with clean hearts. May Christmas morning make us happy to be your children, and Christmas evening bring us to our beds with grateful thoughts, forgiving and forgiven, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Our opening hymn, our Christmas faith hymn, is O come all ye faithful. You may be seated.
Thank you.
have our readings for this evening. And we'll sing after the first reading. If you want to sing Christmas carols, this is the time.
Christmas prophecy, Isaiah 9, 2 through 7. This poem promises deliverance from Assyrian oppression, a hope based on the birth of a royal child with a name full of promise. While Judah's king will practice justice and righteousness, the real basis for faith lies in God's passion for the people. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, upon them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, or people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of the burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The seal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
14. The appearance of God's grace in Jesus Christ brings salvation for all humanity. Consequently, in the present, we live wisely and justly, while also anticipating the hope of our Savior's final appearance. The grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce empathy and worldly passion, and in the present age, to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own, who are zealous for good deeds. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
You'll notice that 274, that the congregation is to sing the last verse. That's this duet. Good to have all of you. We even got one little one, real little one. Good for you. Well, I have. have something here. What do you think this is? Candy canes. All right, everybody take one. Pass them around. There you go. All right. So, do you know the story about the candy cane? What is it? Do you know what it is? Can you tell me? What is when you look at the candy cane, what does it look, what is the white for? Okay, I'm not sure that I quite understand you. The white is for purity. Jesus comes to make us pure. Okay. What about the red? That's the color, yes it is. What do you think it stands for? That's a symbol. I don't know either. All I do without telling you. I'll tell you what it is. Okay? It's about the blood of Jesus. Because this candy maker a long time ago said he wanted to make a candy, some kind of candy that represented Jesus at Christmas. Okay? So when I hold the candy cane like this, what does it look like? Like a candy cane, but the shape is then of a shape of a shepherd's crook, a shepherd's. A shepherd, this is like a walking stick that uses that to groom the sheep. But what if you go like this? Then what does it look like? What does it look like? A J for Jesus. That's right. You got it. That's it. So that's what it all stands for. So that's why it's in the shape it is. That's why it looks like it is. Okay? And so, and then the guy that made these originally put some spice in there because, and what's, you know what spice that is? Starts with P. Peppermint. Peppermint is the real one. And that peppermint spice is to symbolize the spices that the wise men brought to Jesus, okay? And then I've got a little poem that I want to read to you that kind of sums it up, okay? Jesus, the sweetest gift, white for the purity of God's only Son, red for the blood our salvation won, striped for the pain borne on Calvary, he did it all for you and for me, shaped like the staff of a shepherd who came. Jesus is his holy name. So we always need to remember when we're having a candy cane, reminds us of Jesus coming at Christmas time. And so we celebrate that, and we always need to remember that that's the most important thing about Christmas, is that Jesus came. Okay? Thank you for coming out. Want another one? Have another one. Bring it back for some older person. In case there's any. Alright. There you go, Carol. Alright, we're singing again. Are we not? Oh no, we're not either. I got my God. So, we're going to, you can just remain seated. The Gospel of the Nativity, which comes to us from Luke in chapter 2. You all have known it and I'm sure have heard it many times, but one of the things that I always challenge people to, when you hear it more than once, what did you hear that was new? What did you hear that was different? What has it struck you in your mind or your heart about? So, Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the end. So now we'll sing 277, Away in the Manger. Goes like this in chapter 2 of Luke. In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And then an angel of the Lord stood above them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David, the Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you, and you will find a child wrapped in bands of cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." This ends the gospel. Amen. Turn to our hymn now, which is "O Little Town of Bethlehem," 279.
The hopes and fears of all.
60,000 people. It wasn't exactly my idea of a village at all. I'd look more at the village as, well, maybe even as big as Arcadia is. A village like Bethlehem, a small village. We don't know for sure how big Bethlehem was when Jesus was there, but we do know that it was very small. Probably only a few hundred people. And so when you think about being able to find this child in this manger and be able to locate him within a town of Bethlehem, well, it wouldn't be too difficult. Because there was probably only about 300 people, maybe 500, at the very maximum 1,000. A little town of Bethlehem. But one of the things about the little town of Bethlehem is that it's a big deal. It's a little town, but it's a big deal. Who would ever imagine that that little community would be known the way it is, and known like it is? But if you go back, you begin to piece it together, well, maybe there's more to it than that. But one of the things about it is that when you go back far enough, we got to go back to almost 1,500 years. Well, maybe 2,000. And you know, for us to be able to get our arms around that kind of a situation is pretty difficult. We think that a generation or two, 100 years, 200 years is a big deal. But not for them. Because they still remember that this little town is where Rachel died, giving birth to her last child, Benjamin, just outside of the city. And most people would think that, well, why is this happening in Bethlehem? Bethlehem is just a small little burg, and, well, guess what? Jerusalem's only 5 miles away. To go outside of Jerusalem, you're only going halfway to independence. It's not very far. Why doesn't it happen in Jerusalem? Well, it's because there's more to the story. There's more to going on here than just meets the eye. Because this now is the city of David. This is the place in which David was born. And it goes way back in the Old Testament, way back to Ruth and Boaz. David's relatives. And we follow that all the way down to a man named Joseph. And here we are. And so, when we think about it, why not Jerusalem? Why not all the hubbub of that? Most of us think of the big deal as going to the big city. I remember growing up and people would say, especially when they were farther out than I did from Minneapolis, was, yeah, we're going to the cities. It was like there was some great thing to be found there, some wonderful thing, some grand and glorious thing. Well, that's, I'm sure, what people thought about Bethlehem. It's kind of out of the way, in a sense. It's kind of way out of town. That is, out of Jerusalem. And so, we don't necessarily want to have anything to do with it. We don't think it's the right kind of thing. And you know, most of us think about the great and the grand. We don't think about a little town being a big deal. Well, I guess I want you to think about the town of Arcadia. Think about kind of a big deal it is. Because it provides an amazing amount of employment to the whole area. It provides all kinds of services that we wouldn't get in this day and age if it wasn't the way it is. And so, just like Jerusalem, in a sense, Arcadia is kind of a big deal. It has a lot of things to offer, a lot of things that are important, a lot of great things. It's been that way over the years. So now when Jerusalem has grown to a large, large city, and Bethlehem has grown to a city of around 30,000, maybe the size of Winona, and is spread out and down the hill because it's up on the hill. If you think about those pictures from earlier days about the shepherds on the hillside, there you can see up on the hillside the city as it sits. And sort of the city sprawls out on the side of the hill, kind of on a saddle, and kind of flows out from there. Where does it go? It goes down into the shepherd's field. The shepherd's fields that are right there. Right there next to town. Sort of like here, the farms come right up to town. The mixing between, well, we'll say the urban and the rural is close. Bethlehem has become a big deal, even though it's so small and so insignificant. And how great and wonderful is that? But one of the things and one of the secrets is found in the meaning of Bethlehem. It means house of bread. House of bread. What do you think about when you think about bread? I bet you think about some time when you walked into the house or the kitchen and you smelled bread just out of the oven. What a great thing that was. How you wanted to sit down at the table and get a knife out and slather it with butter and maybe jam or honey or whatever you want to put on it. Make a sandwich out of it. How wonderful that is. Because bread becomes the very symbol of the very basics of life. The very basic elements that make up our life. And I think one of the things that's probably unfortunate for us is we don't think about that very often or very much. Because we have so much more. We can buy anything we want, just about. The very basics of life is that bread. The bread that gives life and sustenance to people. If you've watched some of those programs in some of those places around the world that are impoverished, particularly in Africa, and some places in Asia, and even South America, maybe our country too. Of people gathering around and some woman needing some dough, what little meager dough there is, and putting it on a little fire to make bread. Because that's the only thing they'll have all day. Maybe once in a while, supplement it with something else. But it's the very basic thing of life is that bread. And how important that is. And so it shows that this little town of Bethlehem, the house of bread, provided sustenance for everyone, for all people. Then all of a sudden, in a sense, it like the bread, it rose out of this little town to scatter through the whole world and be there and feed the people. And so what does Jesus, as he grows up, claim about himself? I am the bread of life. And the Gospel of John goes on for lots of verses to speak about how Jesus is the bread of life, the very basic element of life, the very basic sustenance that is there. And out of this little town comes this big deal of Jesus. I want to share with you a reading that I ran across a long time ago. And it's, I think, good. It's good for the congregation here to hear, and for all of us to hear. This is one of the smallest churches I've ever worshipped yet. I thought there was room for maybe 60 or 70 people in the pews, and even then, plenty of good seats will still be available among the smattering of people present. As I sat through the service, often looking out the window to a broad, windswept plain, I found myself wondering about the future of this place. How does any tiny congregation survive if alone make a difference, let alone make a difference? When the final hymn was over and the benediction pronounced, I felt a tap on my shoulder. "You're the visitor from headquarters, aren't you?" A man said, extending his huge paw of a hand. At that time, I was working on the national staff of my denomination and was out of the way, on the way on my visit. "I just wanted to know. This church saved my life," he said. "A bunch of others, too. Don't let our size fool you. Whenever I find myself thinking the world is too big, problems too enormous, I remember that little church. It'll never be big or well-known or famous, but just like the rest of us, it's called by the one who came from little, inconsequential Bethlehem. Called to make a difference in the vast world by making a difference in its own place. And just like that little church, we're assured that no matter how big the problems and how small our resources may seem, we can accomplish important things. How can I be so sure? I've seen it with my own eyes in the little church that saves lives." Well, it's a story about a congregation, but it's also a story about us, and maybe about the congregation. This little is only relative. Obviously, 100 people is pretty little compared to a million. But 100 people is fairly large compared to 10. Little town of Bethlehem. A big deal. That came here. Came here in the hearts and lives of people, and look what's happened. Bethlehem survives on tourism. If there was not tourism in Bethlehem, there would be no Bethlehem to speak of. Because millions and millions of people come there to see where this child, God became flesh, God who became a human being and came among us, God who is here, God came to us as a human being. It's a strange thing in some ways, but it's a wonderful thing. It's a miraculous thing. It's something that we as Christian people really need to think about and really need to reflect upon and ponder in our own lives. How wonderful this gift is. And it's not a gift just for tonight or tomorrow, or even for in a week or so. It shouldn't be like a New Year's resolution that is quickly made and just as soon forgotten. A Christmas night like this, and Christmas Day like tomorrow, needs to be something that wraps around us for all year long, not just for some moments, not just for the carols and the candles. One of the things in our house is that we have a whole variety of manger scenes. And some of those come out at Christmas, but there are some that stay out all year. And they should be a reminder to us that God became flesh to us. God became a human being for us. That God is the one who came to us. This morning or this evening, I brought along one. I bought this in 2017. And of course, those of you who know, it's very appropriate. It's all made out of wool. It's one that's out all year round. It's got a couple of sheep, Mary and Joseph, and the baby. And there it is. And it's out all year round. Because we need these reminders every day that God has come to us in a manger. Even though it's something that's made out of wool, some people may would just call it a trinket. But it stands for something far greater. It stands for something that's wonderful that God has done for us and that we need to take to ourselves. We need to remember. And we need to know that when I bought this in Bethlehem, that it's for all year, all time, forever. And so this little town of Bethlehem, just a tiny little place, has made such a difference in the lives and hearts of countless people. In this little town, it has become a bigger deal than anything else. And so may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We sing, "What Child Is This?"
Thank you.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
So please stand and share the peace with each other as you feel comfortable.
Dan, peace be with you.
Yeah, all right.
At this time, we'll take our offering. You may remain seated as we pray together the offering prayer. Let us begin. Eternal God, you make the desert bloom and send springs of water to thirsty ground. Receive these simple gifts of bread, wine, and money, and make us messengers of your mercy and love for all in need of your healing and justice. We ask this through Christ our Savior. Amen. Please rise as you're able. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us join together as we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated, and please come forward to receive communion through the eyes. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you made this holy night shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that here on earth we may walk in the light of Jesus' presence, and in the last day wait for the brightness of his glory. May your light so shine in all our lives to reflect the saving presence of the Lord Jesus each day of our lives. Amen. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, and yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The center candle is the Christ candle, and so we light our candles in succession off of the Christ candle. When we sing the next hymn, Silent Night will be on the projection. Turn to the Christmas psalm, which is Psalm 96, and we read it responsibly. Sing to the Lord a new song.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, bless the name of the Lord.
Proclaim God's salvation from day to day.
Declare God's glory among the nations.
And God's wonders among all peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
More to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols.
But you, O Lord, have made the heavens.
Majesty and magnificence are in your presence.
Power and splendor are in your sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples.
Ascribe to the Lord, honor, and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor due the holy name.
Bring offerings and enter the courts of the Lord.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
Tremble before the Lord, all the earth.
Tell it out among the nations, the Lord is King.
The one who made the world so firm that it cannot be moved, but judge the peoples with equity.
Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad.
Let the sea thunder and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy at your coming.
O Lord, will you come to judge the earth?
You will judge the world with righteousness.
People with your truth.
So we sing Silent Night. Extinguish your candles as we sing Joy to the World, 267.